Have you ever noticed that it seems like practically every small town in the world has one of these parked out and it's parked somewhere? I'm Darren, and this is the Industrial Revolution. Before we answer the question of why that is, let's talk a little bit about this locomotive. This is a Grand Trunk Western 5632. So this locomotive was built to fix a specific problem. The Grand Trunk Western was looking for a faster freight service. They already had good passenger service, but they wanted something that could handle faster freight. Freight, of course, weighs a lot more. You need a different locomotive to handle that. As a result, Baldwin Locomotive Works developed this locomotive. It's the first of the class K4B locomotives. It's a 462 Pacific type locomotive. And there were only three of them ever built. They were built in 1930, and they only stayed in service until 1958. In 1958, they were removed from service due to the dieselization of the railroads. Dieselization's a big word that basically means that they switched from steam-powered coal railroads over to diesel locomotives, diesel electric specifically. Now, why would you do that? Well, diesels are a lot more efficient. They don't require constant maintenance. Steam locomotive, every night you have to put it into the roundhouse. You have to do several hours of maintenance work. When you're running it, you're stopping about every 10 miles or so for water, unless you're set up to use track pans, and most locomotives aren't. And even if you were, you had to be in a place that ran track pans. So they were a great deal of work. Also, they needed a larger crew. You needed not only the maintenance crew, but you had to have the crew to actually run it. You needed a fireman, you needed an engineer, you needed a brakeman, you needed a conductor. None of those are optional positions on a steam train. Go on to a diesel electric, and you can run with a crew of two, typically, for any size train. Here, a little closer look at the running gear on this locomotive. It's pretty heavily built. It was designed as a freight hauler. 72-inch wheels. Allowed it to achieve a maximum running speed of about 80 miles per hour. That's really good for freight service. This locomotive has recently been getting some attention. The first time I was up here, it was pretty rusty. And it looks like it's now had a nice new coat of paint, and people are taking care of it. The fence, unfortunately, is locked, so I can't get inside into the cab. So how did this locomotive end up here? Well, that comes down to the dieselization of the rail fleets also. In the 1800s, early part of the 1900s, this is what you had. If you wanted a train, you went with steam trains. Your only other good alternative was canals, and canals didn't always work. Canals were great if you were in an area that was relatively flat. If you start to put in hills or mountains, the cost of locks and the time it takes to lock through the systems really adds up fast. These didn't have the locking problems that canals have. Canals have one other problem that steam trains did not have, which is that in much of the world, canals kind of freeze solid in the winter. Railroads, as long as you can keep their water tanks open, you can keep running steam trains. By the early part of the 1900s, though, they started experimenting with diesel locomotives. The first direct drive diesels, horrible failures from everything I understand. I've seen one in a museum in Pennsylvania. Need to get out there and shoot it sometime. The wheels look like they do on a steam train, but it has no boiler, has no firebox, no smoke box. It looks weird. If I can get out there, I'll shoot that and put that video up. They realized that direct drive diesel was not the way to go, and they switched over to diesel electric. All modern diesel trains are actually diesel electric. The diesel runs a generator for the electric system. The electrics run the actual wheels. And that's why your wheels can be normal train wheel size instead of these monsters. Switching over to diesel really cut down on the maintenance times. You didn't have to stop every 10 miles or so to add water. You didn't have to put your locomotive into the shop every single night in order to do maintenance on it. You didn't have to have teams of people around to do that maintenance. You didn't have to have several people on the train running it. Train like this, you'd have an engineer and a fireman up front. You'd have a caboose in the back. The caboose would have the conductor, would have brakemen in it, possibly a spare crew. With a diesel locomotive, you run it with typically two people, and you still run it with typically two people today, and there's even some effort being made to switch over to a single person crew. So far less maintenance time. You can run faster because you're not stopping constantly to refill your water tanks, and that's a huge benefit. So railroads started to convert away from the steam trains that they'd used for a century over to diesel. And then World War II happened and stalled everything. So there's a delay there. After World War II, though, they got serious about it. And they started really pushing for the replacement of steam locomotives. Obviously, if your steam locomotive needed a major servicing or major repairs, you didn't fix it, you just got rid of it and put in a diesel. A lot of these others, they said this one wasn't that old. This one they retired at 28 years old, which is, you know, a kid really for steam locomotives. But yeah, it's just to save the money, the long-term savings that you get from not doing the maintenance, from not having the larger crew, made it worthwhile for them. So as they were getting rid of all these steam locomotives, steam has a lot of fans. Steam had a lot of fans in the middle of the 20th century. Steam has a lot of fans today still. And people didn't want all these just sold off as scrap metal. As a result, you have a lot of museums today which have steam locomotives, many of them still running and still pulling passenger trains today. You have a lot more like this that ended up in city parks all over the world. This one was donated here in 1960, and it's been on exhibit since. You see, it's got a nice new shiny coat of paint on it. So when the railroad got rid of their locomotives, what options did they really have? Well, you could, I suppose you could just keep running it until it died. Properly maintained, these things run forever. So that wasn't really an option so much, although it did take out some of the time pressure to switch over to diesel. You could donate it to one of the railroad museums that was being formed specifically to preserve steam railroading history. And a lot of times that happened. Or you can give it to, you know, small towns all over the world. Say, hey, you want a locomotive? Here, take it. Other than that, your only real option was you park it somewhere and let it rust and take up space in your switchyard, or you sell it off for scrap metal. Now, selling off to scrap metal might seem tempting. You look at this and think, you know, that's a lot of scrap metal. And I looked it up, it's actually 255 tons of scrap metal combined between the locomotive and the tender. So that's seems like it would have made sense to scrap that. Until you look at the value of 255 tons of basic scrap iron, which at today's value is only $53,000. So is it worth $53,000 to scrap it? Well, certainly it makes more sense than parking it and letting it just take up space forever. But by donating it out to towns, by donating it to museums, instead of the $53,000 one-time payment, they get their name on, you know, a giant billboard forever. Makes a lot of sense for the railroads to donate it. Makes a lot of sense for people who want to remember the history of steam. So these things ended up in parks and museums all over the world. They're being cared for in various ways. Some are have been left out to rust for decades. Others are being taken care of, like, you know, the fresh coat of paint on this one. And still others, like just up the road actually, is the Pere Marquette 1225, which actually runs steam excursions. So instead of scrapping all these locomotives, the railroad companies donated many of them. Donated to museums, donated to parks. Means little kids that go to the park to play in the playground see this and think about steam. Anyway, I do need your help to keep this channel going. If you've enjoyed the video, please hit like and subscribe. Also, I do have a Patreon page over at patreon.com/industrialrevolution if you get help out there. This channel obviously involves a lot of travel to come out and see stuff like this. So if you could help me out, I'd appreciate that. Membership starts at just a few bucks a month. So old locomotives like this, sitting in parks and museums around the world, remind us of how we got here. They remind us that there was a time before diesel electric locomotives, even before locomotives for that matter. They bring back the age of steam and really the majesty of that era. And that's why this and countless other locomotives like it in parks and museums around the world, this is the Industrial Revolution.